number 7, and this is the presentation of the proposed fiscal year 2015-2016 city budget, brought to us by our finance director, Anna Kwan.
Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, and City Council members, and the members of the public. The item before you tonight is to review and discuss the draft budget as presented, and to provide comments and direction to staff on the budget allocation for the upcoming fiscal year 15-16. Each year, the City Council appoint a budget subcommittee. This year, that subcommittee consisting of 2 council members, Councilmember Glass and Jacob, 3 city staff members, City Manager McLaughlin, City Clerk Gurney, and myself, the Finance Director. The budget process starts in January with the adoption of the budget schedule. The task of the budget subcommittee is to meet with all the department directors and nonprofit organizations to review and analyze their budget as originally submitted. After review of those proposed budgets, the budget subcommittee then makes adjustment to the department budget and nonprofit groups' requests as they deem necessary. The draft budget tonight represents the city proposed financial plan for the upcoming year developed in accordance with the city financial management policies and the guidelines and reflected the city council goals and objectives and how resources are being allocated to achieve these goals. The city total general fund projected revenue is $7.76 million. After review of the departmental budget request as well as addressing the needs assessment list, which will be discussed further in the upcoming slide, the proposed expenditures as recommended by the budget subcommittee are estimated at $7.69 million. The current net budgetary result of $72,000 is proposed to be added to the reserves. This figure, however, does not reflect labor negotiations with bargaining groups, which are ongoing. Once again, the budget subcommittee primary focus is to meet with the department directors to review their budget proposal and make recommendation to the City Council for budget approval. Ideally, labor negotiation with each of the city recognized collective bargaining units should be considered in developing the annual budget. However, this component is considered outside of the budget subcommittee primary focus. Although pending labor negotiations are currently underway, this draft budget does not reflect any potential proposed increase from the bargaining groups. Depending on the outcome of the negotiation, there could be changes to the draft budget balances. The draft budget for fiscal year 15-16 general fund is prepared under the conservative approach. General fund is the main operating fund providing many of the basic services including but not limited to police, fire, parks, planning, and building. Although revenue estimate shows increase in resources, staff continue to be conservative and responsible in developing a budget that maintains service level while continuing to fund new projects to maintain and improve economic vitality of the city. Also note in this pie graph, sales and other taxes totaling approximately $3.8 million, made up of general fund general sales tax, measure T, which is a quarter cent, measure Y, which is a half cent, and measure R of the utility user tax. In addition to the department budget submitted, each department identified additional needs which were allocated as a non-routine operations and maintenance expenditure category, labeled needs assessment list. The original requested amount was approximately $1.7 million. The budget subcommittee had reviewed the request and funded approximately 900 from the need assessment list. Although not all of these items on the departmental needs assessment list fully impact only the general fund, it is crucial that council review and prioritize these assessment lists to determine changes, addition, deletions, if any, to this proposed list as recommended by the budget subcommittee. A late addition to the list as a result of May 19 City Council meeting was the Sebastopol Center of the Art request of the city support for $25,000 for the remodeling of their dining room area, item number 30 on the assessment list. To ensure financial stability and continue with the ability to continue core services during difficult times, the city must establish and maintain appropriate reserve and adopt a prudent reserve policy. The general fund reserve policy was adopted by City Council to Council Policy Number 69. The policy set out for a long-term goal of general fund operating reserve of no less than 15% of the general fund reserve, with the eventual goal of 20% of general fund revenues. This proposed budget reserve is at 15.2%. City staff also present in the draft budget a proposed 5-year financial forecast. This document helped paint a picture of financial status of the city and highlight some of the major challenges the city will need to address in future budgets, such as vehicle replacement costs. This 5-year financial forecast gives us a starting point for the allocation of the available sources to fund necessary future expenditure. To generate a forecast, certain assumptions must be made. The assumption may be modified as more data become available or decisions are made that provide more clarity. The financial forecast includes revenue growth averaging 2.45%, Measure Y half-cent sales tax will sunset on March 31st of 2021, assume no salary adjustment due to pending negotiation, annual health costs grow approximately 5%, which include dental and vision, PERS increase projected 4% through fiscal year 17-18, and no other data available from PERS projected no increase, which is unlikely after 18-19. Other operating costs assumed at 5% annually. Based on the above forecast assumption, the financial forecast indicates surplus in its respective years. The forecast result without any labor negotiation indicates the city needs to implement overall cost reduction measures. Achieving fiscal stability will require increase in revenue and decrease in expenditures. In summary, the city staff are committed to finding creative and impactful solutions to improve services to our residents and businesses and encourage economic growth in the city. This proposed budget is a reflection of the City of Sebastopol's commitment to continue and meet our fiscal challenges while maintaining appropriately responsive service level. City staff and the budget subcommittee are presenting an overview of the proposed budget and are available to answer any questions the council or the public may have. In addition to the public meeting held tonight, there is an online posting of the budget for the public to provide input or voice any concern that they may have regarding the proposed budget. After tonight's public hearing, staff will check direction from the City Council and return on June 16 meeting for review and consideration of approval of fiscal year 15-16 city budget. In accordance with state law, the city budget shall be approved and adopted by June 30th.
As we launch into this discussion, I would like to express my gratitude to the budget subcommittee as well as specifically the, I'm gonna call out somebody other than of the people sitting up here, I'm gonna express my extreme gratitude to our new finance director. The format of the budget is, it's different, it's easy to understand, it's concise, even though it's an inch thick. The formatting and the graphs and everything really work well. So thank you for bringing a new vision for our city budget in more than one way. So we will start with questions of staff from council. Seeing none, we'll move on.
So I had one quick question, just so we're sure to say this out loud. I'm very interested to know how many public meetings there have been today and the future meetings that we have expected. I think there have been 3 or 4 with the budget subcommittee, Mr. City Manager.
I happen to have the schedule here. And we've held public meetings on March 9, where the budget subcommittee reviewed revenue projections. We held, following that, I might add, so the public's aware of the full process that the budget committee goes through. Following that meeting, from March 30th through April 21, the departments each individually submitted their budgets to the finance director, who reviewed it with me, following which the budget subcommittee started their meetings on April 20th and spent hours and hours over the next 3 days meeting with all the departments to go over their individual budgets with each department in depth. Following that, on May 11th, the budget subcommittee held another public meeting, which was the date on which it reviewed in detail the community service agency requests and provided recommendations for the city council on those individual requests. Following which, the next day, the budget subcommittee held another public meeting on May 12th, which was a Tuesday. At that point, the budget subcommittee and members of the public who were present received a full review of the draft budget as it then existed, which is in much the form you see before you tonight, where it's still considered a draft budget. There have been many things happened since then in a number of areas, but primarily the work was done by May 12th, and in a public meeting it was submitted. And then it was sent out to the members of the council. One thing that's new this year that really helped the budget subcommittee focused their attention and helped city staff focus its attention, and I'm hopeful, we're all hopeful that it'll help the council tonight in its analysis, is one of the slides that I showed you, which is in the budget itself at page X near the front. It's part of the budget transmittal letter, which has much the same information that the finance director just gave you this evening in her slide for session. But it is the draft budget subcommittee worksheet, also known as the departmental needs assessment. As I said, during the public meetings, the budget subcommittee went over each of the departmental requests in detail with the department heads. In doing so, they helped prepare, and we did prepare, this list, which you see in the budget, which was in the slideshow, where items that are different, unique, or need special review, items that we don't see every year, a number of things were drawn out of the budget itself and were individually reviewed in detail by the budget subcommittee. Their efforts are shown on this worksheet as it presently exists. You'll see a line entry for the amount that was requested in the original budget request. You'll find in the next column the amount that the budget subcommittee proposed to be budgeted for that item. As you go down that list, you'll see a number of items were either reduced from the original request or were not proposed to be funded at all. There's obviously explanations for all of these. They can be discussed individually or as you select to discuss them. You obviously as well can discuss other things that might not be in this list, but I think primarily the issues that we have in the budget, the issues that will lead to adoption of the budget once they're decided, are primarily found on this particular list. And I found it very useful. I think we've received many compliments on that kind of a format, which really does, I think, focus the council's attention. I will say that a number of these items, when we discuss them this evening, we'll be talking about another idea city staff and the finance director have with the budget subcommittee, and that is that mid-year, after the holidays in January approximately, we propose to have each one of the department heads reassess their individual departmental budgets at that time for a mid-year review. How accurate was that? Things that we thought we would do, what we no longer wish to do, are those cost estimates still accurate? Go through that with an eye toward staff coming back and reporting on each one of their departmental budgets. At the same time, we will update our revenue projections and see where we are at that time, continuing as we do, because it's an ever-changing subject, continuing to forecast what our revenues and expenditures will be. With that exercise, it is theoretically possible that some items can be proposed to be looked at again in January, or some more limited amount of funding can be proposed for certain items with a review again in January. So I think it's important for the council to realize that you don't necessarily have to make the final decision on everything this evening. Sometimes staff can get by without necessarily receiving something, as long as we know that we're going to reassess it again in the fairly near future. So I'm sorry for the long-winded response, but I think it's important that the public and the council, the rest of the council, know the hard work that the budget committee did, how we focused on the budget towards trying to pinpoint issues that need discussion and review, and what we propose to do in the future.
So I think it's important for me to comment that I believe our process is very transparent. We've had three public meetings already with a budget subcommittee where folks can come. The information has been available, and I'm thinking this council may have another meeting after tonight. So we're providing the opportunity to folks to go through all our numbers and question them and comment to us as council members and ask questions of staff. So I think this community values that transparency, and it's important to keynote that it is there right now.
True. And they are our numbers as a community. They're not our numbers as a city government.
I'm working off an old X. Do you have any extra copies of our current?
And then the slideshow has number 30 on there that isn't in this one.
Correct.
Right, just so people can know that.
Right. And that was noted in the presentation from the staff report that was it 2 weeks ago we heard an item that was a request from the Center for the Arts to help with a fire sprinkler upgrade to their facility. And so the council added that as line item number 30 on page Roman numeral 10, which is not reflected, at least in my draft. I know it was there. I'm not sure if it's in the draft that's in the back table. So council member Glass, looks like you're angling
towards my microphone, which I need to turn on. I just wanted to comment about the process that the budget subcommittee went through. I want to thank the staff, in particular Anna, but also all the department heads who have that onerous task of making a case for why they need more money. And they all do it very convincingly and very well. And I want to thank our city manager, who always just is very good at crystallizing everything and making the policy choices pretty clear. And my fellow budget committee colleague, this was my first time on the budget committee, and as everyone knows, I'm the new kid on the block on the council. So trying to digest all this financial information, which is this thick, is really a lot of work, and it's a lot of brain crunching. I I did want to say a couple of things as I go through, as I went through this, as and now I'm being long-winded. It's early. We have until 11. Oh yeah, closed session. Okay. First of all, it became very clear to me how hard it is to project all the pieces of this budget, because it's not like you can just, if you've been in a for-profit business for 10 years, you know you're going to expect sales to be kind of like this, and your expenses to be kind of like that, and it's more or less predictable. But a lot of what our city has to do is we have all of these expenses, but then we're half the time we're taking a long shot on, hey, are we going to get that grant? And the grant is not a trivial amount of money. It's not like, oh, we're going to increase our sales by 3%. It's, are we going to get the $750,000 or are we not? So when you go and look out 5 years, you can look at what your general fund is going to look like, and that's pretty predictable. But when you have specific things like capital improvements and bike lanes and all of these kinds of improvements that our community wants to have, that whether we're going to get the funding for it outside of the general fund is hard to predict, because a lot of the time we're applying for a grant sometimes several times over, as Sue could definitely tell us. So as I look at all those moving parts, it's pretty hard to have a very precise five-year projection. And what I did discover was, gosh, especially after I looked at the next, what's going to be the next item on the agenda, which is the capital improvements program, my goodness, we really have a very large nut to crack. There's a huge amount of things that are unfunded, and we're really going to have to do some real thinking about this. And the other thing is that I'm not sure that the public always understands exactly, this is such a great document for people to look at, because you can see where our money's coming from. There's some really important information in here, like when we increase our retail sales by $1 million, our city gets $10,000 in increased revenue. Well, so $10,000, for a city, that doesn't really pay for it pays for maybe a tenth of a position. If we're having somebody on staff and we need to add somebody, now they're between benefits and retirement and everything, it's gonna be close to $100,000. So if it's $1 million, gets us 10,000, we probably need to increase our sales by $10 million just to add one staff position. If you think about those kinds of numbers, that's kind of scary. There are other sources of revenue we have to be thinking about, like transient occupancy tax, what's the right mix of that, what kinds of revenue sources can we look at. But we have to understand that our revenue is really, our options are very much dictated by the state of California, and where our hands are tied in many ways. So when you look at this big picture, the federal government isn't letting a lot of stuff trickle down to local government, and we're the people that are in the front lines delivering services. So please understand that we have to make a lot of tough decisions here, and I think we tried to make some good ones. But obviously this process is open so that we can hear from the public if we've made mistakes and not made good decisions. So, and I would really recommend reading this incredibly enlightening material that may help you with insomnia if you have it. But there's really good information in here about what our budget looks like, where the revenues come from, and quite a bit about what our options are. So I want to thank you for providing that to us and to the public.
Any other opening comments? Councilmember Jacob.
In page schedule. On page X of the opening letter of the budget, line 2, it says funded amount is 58,500. Actually, funded amount is 55,400. Is there an updated list from staff around community grants and funding and where that those each got funded at? I just have my handwritten list that the committee submitted to staff.
The original amount submitted to staff, or are you looking at the amount that's funded for the 55,400?
55,400.
If you go to page 26 of the budget book.
So I don't know if subcommittee members got a budget, but we got the original budget, but then we didn't get updates. So I think budget subcommittee members are more out of date than the non-budget subcommittee members as far as materials. Just
no, you all got the same book.
Yeah. I didn't get that.
You have
a
book? The community support item line 2 in the budget subcommittee worksheet is found in the budget on page 26. And that is, to the best of our understanding, and I think that figure you just gave us, Councilmember Jacobs, is found on the list, 55,400 being the total proposed. That's the list of proposed funding for each one of the community groups.
Somehow I missed in my very small box of City Hall this nice binder item. So I must have it somewhere and just didn't realize what it was. So I just have over docs, so I think I'm caught up now, thanks.
And since we're discussing this particular page 26, it would be useful to receive the applications from the requestees of the Community Benefit Grant Program. In other years, we were able to see those. To see what they're going to use, what their proposal is for the use of the funds, and just maybe we can, you can, that can be disseminated via email to us tomorrow.
Assuming we may need to go past one more meeting to do the budget, then we'll certainly, we'll provide that for you tomorrow, and then we can use next time. Mm-hmm. We have, I believe, that information with us potentially to answer some individual questions if we can locate it readily enough, but we don't have an analysis of each one of these requests because that work was done by the Budget Committee as it went through each one of the requests at this public meeting.
Understood. And I'm not saying that it needs to be part of the budget book, I'm just saying that perhaps it would have been useful. So, Councilmember Eater?
Well, I'd like to echo the thanks that have been expressed to both the finance director and to the budget subcommittee and to all the city staff for this. It's obviously a lot of work. And the formatting and the presentation are I used the word refreshing previously, I'll use it again. It's great. It's very helpful. I think it's a good product that allows our citizens to understand what, you know, basics of city finances, where the money comes from, is where the money goes. I don't have, I'll have more detailed questions later, but right now, I just get many thanks.
Well, I think that we are probably at the point where we should begin with some of our detailed questions. And I'm sure that each one of us has any number of them. So, where to begin? I see no hands in the air.
Regina and I have asked that question.
I know. Vice Mayor Green?
This may be a request of the budget subcommittee if they're willing to give us a little more time tonight. I'm very curious how you together made the decisions to not fund the item, so you're selecting something over something else. For instance, with community grants, there are, I think, two significant to the community that were unfunded, but I don't know what those people were wanting money for or why they did it.
They request money.
Is it there? Just that's the old list?
Yeah, so basically what you saw on this is the continued funding, matching last year's funding, which all were initially applied.
Uh-huh.
And we funded new requests, which there were two at a moderate level.
Okay, so if I'm reading it correctly, then BBC didn't ask, put in a request.
No.
Okay. Good. Did you want to comment about the other items on the needs assessment that you decided not to fund?
I think that it's important to recognize that the budget subcommittee did its job in presenting a balanced budget to the city council for us all to consider. I don't believe that either one of the budget subcommittee members, I'll allow you to speak for yourself, but that I have author's pride. It's presented here for the council to make final decisions and adjustments. I think what you'll find is the things that we funded first were items that were already funded, already in process, or needed to be completed funding, like community center. You'll notice we funded the items that are under construction and did not fund the items that are not already under construction. You'll see a theme there. And then on top of that, we funded items that department staff needed or specifically requested and had a strong need for. One of the items that was talked about a bit was the police department training simulator. And we saw there was a need that in that value, there was mental health training, there was dealing with different isms or other items that police are taking a lot of criticism for across the country. There was significant training within that system for our local police department to ensure that, to help ensure that our police force had proper training to not make some of the mistakes that we've seen happen across the country. Specifically, there's this, the bicycle feasibility study and the downtown parking plan, which are both important items that I know we've gotten quite a bit of electronic feedback for. But I can get into more details when that item comes up, or I can just tell you now that the subcommittee really looked at the amount of money that the city has spent on bicycle pedestrian improvements historically. We also have found that in the past, these types of feasibility studies are funded by grants. By taking our time to apply for those grants appropriately, this can be funded fully by a grant. And it seems inappropriate for the city council to use very sacred general funds for something that's grant fundable. It's how we funded every single feasibility study in the past for bicycles in this county, is through grant funding. And this specific request is for us to use taxpayer dollars out of the general fund. So I think that was really where I was coming from, making that decision. That is still open to more discussion on that item. There's pieces here that will. In addition, we just applied for $1 million grant to do our current bicycle improvements. And upon approval of that grant, we will need to do 10% matching, which means the city will need to come up with $100,000 in order to implement our current feasibility study. So in seeing those expenses we've already spent and the expenses coming up in that realm, it seemed prudent for us to bring it to the larger council for a bigger discussion. The budget subcommittee did not consider the $25,000 sprinkler fire upgrade request from the Center for the Arts. It came in behind the budget subcommittee's process, but was suggested by the council to add to this budget. So just for intents and purposes, that's a discussion we need to have here. The budget subcommittee never had that discussion. There are items on here that I'm comfortable, every item on here, I think as a subcommittee member, looking forward to talking about seeing where everything lands.
I could just add something to that. On all the items, especially on the departmental needs assessment list or the worksheet, we have somebody here prepared to address or talk about any one of those items that council members have a question about. But just to give you the overview one more time, this budget is basically in a balanced position right now with a relatively small amount of money left over proposed for reserves, but it does not include the results of the ongoing labor negotiations with three represented groups. So the process is to try and bring all these different things together at the June 30th finish line. Mm-hmm. But we don't have figures for everything, obviously, at this point. So that's why I'm suggesting this evening, we're here ready to answer questions and provide details, staff is, on every one of these items for which you have a question. Other than that, the council may wish to exercise some caution at this point because labor negotiations, again, are ongoing.
Council Member Lutz?
The other half of the budget subcommittee, I thought maybe I'd go through and say some of my reasoning on what I did, what my thoughts were, and I retrieved my scribbled notes, so hopefully I will remember what I was scribbling about. We looked at each of the, this is like looking at page X and, you know, how I made my decisions. And the first thing was the library landscaping ongoing project, and we thought, you know, it's certainly a very worthy project, but I think the subcommittee, when we looked at that over, we thought, well, you know, maybe we can give a little incentive and give a significant contribution to that, but maybe some additional money could be raised. So that's why that came in a little lower than what was originally asked for. Then there was, the community support, I'm not sure what that is. The Muni Code update made a lot of sense because that's making our municipal code searchable, which is certainly something that the public would like, is to be able to look up what our rules and laws are, but it's also kind of usable for staff to be able to look stuff up without it taking 3 hours to look it up. So that seems like a actually time-saving thing. We sacrificed ourselves and did not approve $5,000 to buy new chairs. So we are still sitting here in uncomfortable chairs. That was for
as are all of you.
Yes, that was for the city council. $40,000 that was requested for the website, that wasn't just cosmetic. It's because there's issues with our website right now. It's old technology, and it's kind of limping along. And the last thing we want is our website to go down because it's an essential form of communication now. So that's why we agreed to the budget subcommittee, at least I agree, can't speak for my colleague over there, but I agreed to full funding for that because the last thing we want is for that to blow up. The new financial software, the city has been using a package that is unusual, that a lot of cities are not using. It's kind of a non-standard package. So I have like some, I think we need to make a conversion. I have a little bit of concern about doing it this fast, there's no doubt in my mind you need to do the conversion. The timing, I'm a little open to, you know, how that could be wobbled a little bit, in implementing that, you can't implement stuff like that without having budgeted for some extra help to make it happen. Installing new financial software is extremely time intensive, and you need some people with experience to help you with that. Agreed, the budget subcommittee funded a full-time equivalent administrative assistant. We have our city manager, city attorney, our city clerk, and our finance director are all functioning, and there may be more people actually, I think it's our planning director, are all functioning without an admin. Like, you know, imagine a private company having executives with no administrative assistant. That's pretty tough. So it seemed to me it was a worthwhile investment, because then we're having somebody at a lower pay scale copying. Geez, that seems like a good idea to me. Then we have set aside for the new fire engine. Well, we don't want anything burned down.
I believe that's mislabeled, but that's actually the last payment of a lease payment.
Yeah, that's right.
That's actually the final payment
of
a lease payment on a fire truck, not setting aside money for a future fire truck.
Yeah, that's right. All right, thank you. Boy, he's remembering better than I am. But he's younger, so. Then there was the police simulator training equipment. I think Councilmember Jacob already addressed that. I very strongly we look at the problems we're having nationwide with policing issues, and I think the police department made a very compelling presentation about this equipment that would be training our police department in the kinds of things that police officers should be trained on. But our awardee this evening, our police officer who Chief Weaver talked about his ability to deal with mentally ill people, etc. This equipment is all about training police officers to dispel sticky situations without force, to deal with mentally ill people without resorting to force. And that seems like a good investment to make sure that we don't find ourselves in an ugly situation like so many cities throughout the country are finding themselves in now. I can't comment on the next one because I get money from those guys in my job. The assistant planner position, I think our planning department is got a huge workload. We're in the middle of a general plan update, and I think that their need for assistance is very evident. I can't remember what the discussion about the arborist was, but I'm sure it's $4,600. The Laguna Reserve Management Plan, I believe that's been an ongoing project, and so it makes sense to not stop in the middle of doing something. There's $6,000 for LAFCO that has to do with annexation of Village Park, and that is clearly something that we should continue. We need to move forward with the $100,000 in the bike trail feasibility study. I think Council Member Jacob already talked about that, that we have our funding bike trails. We're already funding a feasibility study for another trail. However, it was my feeling that this is the kind of thing that we should apply for a grant. So you don't want to use general fund money, like precious general fund money, on something that's grantable. But the other thing is that we will find out the results tomorrow morning of the measure. I think I've got my I voted button on here. Hopefully, some of the proceeds, if that measure passes, some of those proceeds we can use not only to repair roads here in Sebastopol, but we can use them for non-motorized transportation, which would include bicycle planning and bike studies. And so rather than putting general fund money in the budget for that item, we're hoping to see that we get a good outcome on that on that vote. We had the downtown parking study. We didn't fund that right now because we just don't have that much money, but it seems like that's another thing that could be part of perhaps a part of that public-private situation, so it could get funding elsewhere. The general plan update, obviously, we've got to keep funding that. We, by law, need to update our general plan, and we're in the middle of it. We have to keep funding that. On looking at our community center, all those different outlays, we stuck with funding the projects that are ongoing, and we're thinking of delaying the ones that we're not working on yet, so that we can spread out the expense over a couple of years, or several years. Then there's the new emergency vehicle. We didn't find the money to do that. The economic development coordinator, I have to say, at first I was kind of, well, I don't know about that, and I was a little skeptical, but then what captured my attention about that was the notion of that person engaging in working on putting together a new business improvement district, business assessment district. As everybody probably knows, we lost our redevelopment agency money, but there's this other mechanism called a business assessment district. And if we can pull off doing something like that, then we're replacing some of the money that we had lost from the state of California because of the, it's a business improvement district. And to create something like that, we have to have somebody to work with the business community that understands how that comes together and how that works legally in order to interface with the business community to talk to them about, can we do this? And because it needs the business community's buy-in. So that's exploring that as an opportunity, which would actually be enhancing our economy, and that's what got me sold on that concept. Then there's the citywide IT support. I don't, my personal opinion is that we can probably get that cheaper, but this is kind of a placeholder, and hopefully we can get that at a cheaper rate. But obviously we need IT support because we've got some problems with our computer network now, and that's kind of the basis of it. So that's a summary of my scribbled notes on why I decided what I decided on when we went through this page X.
I concur that Greg is 8%.
Yeah, he didn't agree with me all of that.
Almost all of
that. Okay, that's really helpful to hear from you guys in detail because you spent so much time on it already. The one question I have now is understanding the priorities with the community centers remodel. I just want to double check that I'm anticipating that those follow the list of Diana's priorities and some we had already decided on as top priority.
They're already in process.
Right.
It's under construction pretty much, and we've committed to the funds. And if you remember, this is the third time we approved, the third budget cycle that we've approved the community center remodel. It's just been delayed. We approved all of this money previously. This time we're only able to approve things that we're already financially committed to.
So this is a carryover.
These are things we're financially, it's a carryover.
Right.
And I just realized this is a really pertinent thing that I think probably everyone on the council understands, but the public may not all understand, and that's that, as everyone knows, there was this big financial meltdown back in 2008. The city found itself in very dire circumstances, and we did not have enough money. And so the way that the city made it through that, rather than laying people off, the city manager at that time worked with the city staff, and staff all agreed to cut back on their hours and our public works department and our unrepresented staff agreed to cut back to 4 days a week, and thereby actually cutting their salary very significantly. And for, you know, some people, this was quite a hardship. And they also agreed to, there were also other compromises that had to do with payment on their contributions to retirement funding and some health benefits. So that's how the city made it through that very, very difficult time. But the agreement that was negotiated at that time was kind of backloaded, and now we're, oh gosh, now we're having to deal with this big increase. So what happened was that they took this big cut in year one, and it was a five-year plan. There was a memorandum of understanding, and that restored ours gradually over a five-year period, with the biggest hit coming in the last year. Guess what? That's this year. So this isn't, you know, there is an increase in personnel costs this year that are just due to a contractual agreement that was made prior to our current city manager and prior to this council that we have to agree to. But it's also, we made that agreement with our really excellent staff, so obviously we should be living up to the agreements that we made. And I have to say, you know, we may be wringing our hands over the cost of this now, but it was the sacrifices of our city staff that got us through that really bad economic time. So we are gradually restoring services, but the other thing to know is that the staff didn't just take a hit in terms of their income, but a lot of staff was doing the same amount of work in less time, and there were a lot of things that couldn't get done. I mean, it's not like we were overstaffed. So here we had this, you know. So anyway, that has some, also a significant impact on our budget this year.
Vice Mayor Gray?
Well, I just want to check with the subcommittee on another point of conversation potentially. I'm wondering if you evaluated items from an additional funding source, which might be called crowdsourcing now, crowdfunding, fundraising in the community to assist. I think to the way our Rotary Club, one of our clubs, re-landscaped the exterior of the post office and painted the exterior with a three-color paint job as a donation. I know, I think this building was built with donated labor. So I'm just wondering if you vetted any of these projects to see if they might be suitable for that kind of work in our community. And if not, we can talk about it at a later time, because I'm really interested in that. And I think if we don't have the revenues to the city right now, there may be some items that are within a reasonable price range that we may want to talk to our people about to get them underway. I'm thinking of things like the kitchen upgrade at the community center, the restroom upgrade, the tile, those particular projects.
I think that that's a very worthy discussion. However, it's probably beyond what we're trying to do tonight. So remind us. Remind those people on the agenda setting committee. We'll discuss that.
Well, those people.
Those people. So I think we
actually, so quick.
Yes, please.
In the five-year forecast graph, bar graph you showed, there was a pretty sharp uptick in FY16-17 expenditures. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Because all the other years looked pretty consistent.
So on the need assessment that we have, the new emergency rescue vehicle that we're going to go ahead and delay into the following year, so the spike is to put down the $450,000 to purchase. The plan is to purchase the vehicle, the rescue vehicle, next year, not 15-16, but 16-17. So that caused the spike in the bar graph.
Okay. Is that a purchase as planned in one fiscal year? Or over time, like a lease purchase?
Well, it's a placeholder for now.
Okay.
That we said that we going to need to replace that rescue vehicle for 16-17 for $450,000.
I see.
That's an estimate of what it would cost based on the knowledge that we have now. I mean, the fire chief can address this if you'd like to ask him the question about it, but we're committed to exploring all options for that vehicle. But when it wasn't funded this year, we put it to the next year, and as the finance director said, that's what causes this fire.
And I'm not sure who to direct this question to. It was mentioned that the one of the major functions of the Economic Development Services position would be to try to implement a business assessment district or business improvement district. The funding for a district like that comes from what source?
The businesses themselves.
They
assess themselves a tax.
Okay, so we would create a city position, conceivably, to oversee assessing the local businesses charges to fund a district within the city. So it'd be funded by the merchants in town, the businesses.
If that's what the economic development specialist was tasked to do, that's how it would occur. We've not completely analyzed how this position would be staffed, whether it would be contract or employee, nor all the duties that the person might undertake. So this item is here in the budget. It was, as you earlier this last month, the item was presented to the council for the first time. So what staff is doing, what you've been hearing, are some thoughts that staff has as to the possible uses of that position, but it's not been completely developed.
Okay. And the library landscaping project, I forget, but it seemed like originally it was a part city paid, part donation funded project, and I've lost track of how much has been received in donations versus what the city had originally agreed to pay. Does anybody have any sense of that?
I think we've had considerable labor contributions. Monetary contributions have fallen short, which is why it's been put to the budget.
Okay.
There's also another dimension to it. The parts remaining are not easily done by volunteers because they involve a steep slope and like bringing in boulders.
Okay.
So this part that's remaining needs to be contracted out more than volunteered, as opposed to what we did with the lawn and the planter boxes.
But it seems like the city is winding up, and I understand in lieu contributions of labor and materials, but it looks to me like the city's winding up paying lion's share of that project. Is that accurate?
That is accurate. The budget subcommittee struggled with this item a bit because it was proposed to be funded by donations, but realistically speaking, that hasn't really happened yet. So the budget subcommittee determined to fund it to a more limited extent, but to fund it, the realization that to carry that project through to its conclusion, we likely would have to pay for it out of city funds. That does not mean the donations effort would stop, but the history of the donations have been that they've been a struggle to obtain.
Okay. And then I'll wait till after public comment. There's my comments.
Okay. So I've got some questions with fairly specific sort of. In every departmental budget, it's titled liability, property, flood insurance from Rita. A description, is it actually flood insurance that each department carries? Can you describe what the title of that means?
Those that are prorated, yes, we do have flood insurance, and we have to pay for it through REMA, and we prorate it, we prorate it amongst the city departments.
I see. So I ran through these numbers, and in total for the entire city, it's an increase over last year of $31,260 out of $202,736. In other words, it's a 15% increase over last year. Is that REMIF-wide,
or because we're next to the Laguna, we're...
No, it's REMIC-wide. The way that the insurance cooperative system works is the insurance is procured on behalf of all the member agencies and for the use of those who actually would incur the claim, i.e. have a flood or whatever else is covered. REMIC cannot cover everything through the city contributions to REMIC. It has to obtain insurance for extraordinary expenses of things that are not likely to happen, but if they do, they're extraordinarily expensive. So insurance is procured for that. Each year they go out and obtain quotes and negotiate for the best coverage at the lowest cost that they can find. But obviously that varies each year. And when those figures are received from REMIC in the early spring, then they are plugged into the budget, basically the same as all the other cities.
And I'm going to guess that historically those numbers have never actually dropped.
Well, I have many REMIC examples back at the office that I could share because they have many different insurance coverages. In a number of cases, they have been successful in actually negotiating occasionally a reduced premium, more often the premium not being increased. But they do negotiate those individually each year on behalf of all the cities. It's under the guidance of the board of directors of REMIC, who scrutinizes every one of those in their bi-monthly board meetings that they have, and hear the staff reports and then approve them.
Just when I hit equals and found out that it was a 15% increase, it got my attention because that's substantial.
If I may, if you go to page 80 of your budget book, it has historical, the last 2 years, the insurance is ranging about $230,000 or $200,000.
Next question. On page 6, Roman numeral 6 of the transmittal letter, I had a question from a community member about franchise fees. Can you explain what they are and how they work?
Year for budget purposes, they're estimated because they're based on the franchise holder paying a percentage of the actual they're supplying the service.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the fees are estimated, and that's what you see in the budget would maybe there.
So basically what we're doing is collecting fees from PG&E and video cable TV franchise operators. The fee is then providing them the right to deliver service within the city of Sebastopol.
Right. The theory is that they use our public streets or our poles. They're all using public properties to supply these services. Therefore, the law allows cities to collect a franchise fee for that.
Okay.
Most of those are based on a percentage of revenues. So since the revenues vary, so would the fee each year. So we try and estimate those.
Got it. So I answered the question correctly.
That's good, Peter.
let's see. That one's already answered. Page 18. Page, the SAFER grant. I realize that went away and that we're hoping that it comes back. Any movement, any knowledge that's been learned on that one?
So I wrote that grant back in March, and unfortunately with FEMA, it's like a 6-month waiting period. So I probably won't know until the fall, maybe late summer, early fall.
And what was the grant amount?
$400,000 spread over 4 years, $100,000 a year.
And this covers quite a bit for our volunteers down at the
firehouse. Out-of-pocket expenses and firefighter retention. It's not a recruitment program or grant, it's retention.
Okay. So we'll just wait to hear the good news on the SAVOR grant.
Yes.
Okay. Let's see, jumping all the way over to page 87. So this is under the debt service, and the section talks about the infrastructure lease and the purchase of the village home park property. And various infrastructure financing. And then we get into fire engine lease, page 86, 87. And so this velocity pumper fire engine lease, that final payment that was noted on page Roman numeral 10 of 69,000 and change, that then we will own that.
Yeah, so our last payment for our newest fire engine, last payment is in September. So it falls in, that's why if you're looking at it on the 15-16 budget. So that's the last payment. And then under the needs assessment list, I went ahead and pushed out the next purchase. We need a heavy rescue. The rescue that we have now is a 1990, it's 25 years old. Historically, a fire engine or rescue emergency equipment lasts 20 years, and then we need to put it off in reserve. But I wanted to help the city out for this go around. I actually haven't sat down yet with the manufacturer to spec one out. So I mentioned to Anna, go ahead, and we're not going to budget it for the 15-16, but we truly will need to budget it for the 16-17 year. Mm-hmm. And it'll be a $450,000, $500,000.
So basically what we'll be doing is just taking a year off from the same payment.
Correct.
So the question on this one though, we own this now.
We will in
We'll own it in September.
In September, it was a 5-year lease and that's what we've done historically.
Okay. So then turning the page, we get into dump truck lease and things that are, according to the dates listed here, that have already expired, or is this incorrect information? Dump truck lease expired in 2014 in February. Energy conservation loan was paid in full 2014.
Yeah, that would be a clerical error.
Okay, no
that's
problem. That's why. Why we have questions?
That just needs to be removed, right?
Off the books.
Okay.
Great. Okay, so those are my questions. I'll have a few comments. Councilmember Eder?
I apologize, but a couple more questions. On page 6, it refers to a transfer to a Woodstone Assessment District fund. I couldn't find this before. I'm not familiar with that. I don't know what that is.
The Woodstone Assessment District is on the south end of town behind the hotel.
Was that like a housing
it's the
development?
Name for the live work units that are just south of the hotel.
Okay.
Right.
All right. I wasn't sure about that. And
so that was for the public improvements in that area.
That's fine. Thank you. I thought it was like some secret fund, you know. Just kidding. This belongs to the CIA. Yeah. But anyway. The other thing is I just want to clarify that this list of 29, well now 30 items, these numbers don't take into account any adjustments that result from labor negotiations.
Correct. They do take into account the additional 1.5 hours to the restoration of the 40. It doesn't take anything else into account.
Okay, so as much as we would like to set these in stone and approve them, basically, they're still subject to variation.
Until the labor negotiations are complete.
The council's been through 4 hours so far, at least to 4 hours of discussions in closed session. It is appropriate to a limited extent to discuss some budgetary items during city council closed sessions concerning labor negotiations. So council should bear in mind when we're looking at these items, it is not just a matter of relating these items to the rest of the budget or to each other, but the council should bear in mind that when labor negotiations are concluded, we will have to likely find some sum of money with which to conclude those with. And this same list is a useful tool for searching for that amount of money, unless, of course, the council wish to use some of its reserves.
And my final question, and I mean it this time, on page XI11, Roman numeral 11, it talks about the RFP that we are putting out for Pine Grove project for the new civic center downtown, possibly. And I'm wondering if once we send those out and receive back the responses, then what? Because I don't see it as even an unfunded project on this list.
Well, we're not sure what we're going to get back, because we weren't sure what we were asking for, because the project could take any number of forms. So we will wait for the RFPs to be returned and bring it back to council with a report, and that's what mid-year budget adjustments are for, and the January reassessment that's been proposed.
The RFP was structured to be very open-ended. It actually could elicit a developer with a proposal to actually do a project, i.e. no expense to the city, or we can get proposals from consultants who would develop a package on behalf of the city to present to interest potential developers, in which case we would, as the mayor stated, have to return to the council for additional funding if we continue that project. But it was deliberately done open-ended to elicit both types of response. And I will say about that, we've received a number of inquiries about that proposal, and the comments I've heard was that it was greatly appreciated that we did it in that way. But the only problem with it is we don't know what we're going to get till August when they arrive.
Okay, thank you. That's it.
Okay.
I promise this is my last question for right now. I just want to check in with Sue Kelly, looking ahead to item number 8 that we still have to get to. I'm looking at the pavement program, and what I'm understanding from that report in item number 8 is that in this budget there is no funding dedicated to pavement management program.
That's correct.
That's correct. So,
sort of correct. There's no plan to transfer funding into the pavement reserve in 15-16. I was instructed that there would be future transfers to assume future transfers in succeeding fiscal years. Mm-hmm. So we've been putting $150,000 a year into the pavement program from special sales tax, but 15-16 represents a suspension of that transfer.
And I think we've heard from you, we need something like over $500,000 a year to that program, just to bring our pavement up to some level closer to 70, which is the goal, and we're at 60.
Well, we need like millions to do that, but, and I'll talk about it more when we get to the CIP. But yes, we're currently averaging about $200,000 a year in spending on pavement. And it's way less. We're going to continue to lose ground.
And so it doesn't do much. I mean, Keating.
It does something.
Right.
Not
it
much.
Does something, but like Keating Avenue is going to cost more than that. And it's a tiny street that services a few addresses.
Yeah, that's
and, you know, I mean.
That one actually we got a grant for.
Well,
but it's
I know
still
we have
a
grant.
$250,000
Right.
Project.
I was just using that to as an example of something and what cost gets us. So. For instance, if we're looking at punching Willow through from South Main over to Petaluma Avenue, we don't have a fund that's going to be able to pay for that. If we wanted to repair Willow as it goes around the pool, that street's now down to the dirt. We don't have any money being contributed to that. And best case scenario, we're hoping after 1 year of suspense, we can contribute and we'll get behind more than we have money for.
Well, this might be an appropriate time to mention that we may get some limited amount of relief from Measure A if it passes, which we should know at some point in time, probably this evening or thereabouts, and that, of course, all remains to be seen. I also comment that in the city manager meetings I attend, there's a great amount of frustration amongst all the local cities. None of the cities have adequate funding to meet their roads and their other infrastructural needs. And the problem, frankly, is it's Sacramento, and it's hurt us, and we don't get the funding level that we used to, and we can't create money. You know, we can't print it in the basement, so we don't. It's just an incredibly frustrating thing. And when the numbers get very large, then it almost makes it easier in a sense. Well, we definitely don't have millions. So that's not a proper way to meet our public need. But right now, it's a question without a lot of answers. And by the way, we're not the worst city in terms of our road condition, but we're also certainly not the best.
But we're catching up. We're going down.
We're catching up in a negative way.
Catching up with the worst.
Well, if printing money in the basement helps, I can run a few sheets.
I thought you were going to go to the police department.
What?
So, I think it's time for us to hear from the public on our budget discussion. So, if any member of the public wishes to offer thoughts, Lynn, since you're stationary.
Did you have John bring a mic?
Yeah, thank you. I wanted to address the funding for the bike trail study, which is currently zero. The idea of crosstown trails that connected all the neighborhoods was proposed a long time ago, over 6.5 years ago, to the council, and we've jumped through a lot of hoops after that and put a lot of hard work into it, and we're willing to jump through a lot more hoops and do a lot more hard work to move this thing along, because there's the potential for some gorgeous trails to cross our town and connect the neighborhoods. But time's running out on this. Sebastopol has no natural corridors, and so we have to use a significant amount of private property to move a trail across town. And that means the willingness of these private property owners that will cooperate. And it looks like there are many, but they tend to be older than me. And time moves on, and the opportunity to work with these private property owners is going to pass, and it's really going to limit the ability of what you can do in this town. And I just think, you try to find a trail, and every property is developed in one way or another, except for about six in this whole town. So that's a significant problem. Got to move ahead on this. And it's time to get this project rolling. And where we are right now, it's not going to come through grants, because it's really stated right off the top in the bicycle transportation account from the state of California that any public funding requires that it be in your bicycle and pedestrian master plan. And these trails aren't in any form in there. And so that is a first step. Well, we tried that and ran into concerns, we'll call it. So doing that is very clearly spelled out in the bicycle transportation account and in our own bicycle and pedestrian master plan, and if you look closely, nothing close. So until that's taken care of, those grants are not available. Una has suggested looking at Measure A funds that might come our way. I read in the Press Democrat, a portion of those funds must be used for bicycle infrastructure.
Thanks, Lynn. Please come forward.
Since I have the mic, do you want to go? Hi, Jim Wheaton on Jesse Street. I wish I had more time to review the budget. I feel frustrated. I'm sure a lot of people do. I'm sure you guys do. I'm surprised at how much things cost. Like, I just, $450,000 for an emergency vehicle. I don't know. I'm sure that's what they are. I just am surprised at how much things like that are. I'm surprised at pavement costs. I mean, it seems like it's contractor kind of normal stuff. We should be able to fix that road in front of Ives Pool. I'd ride my bicycle along there and go jiggy 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 every day. And so there's a sense of frustration because I know when we do raise taxes, we always mention, oh, we need money to fix our roads, which I think is kind of important, and yet it's not happening. It seems to be. So I don't know what to suggest other than that it's very frustrating, I think. Finally, my only comment is, as new things come along, like this business development position, I would really like to see at least potential return on investment. You know, how could this possibly pay for itself? You know, are we going to tax the local merchants $40,000, for example, over a certain amount of time? Is that a reasonable number to say, you know, because you'd have to actually tax them much more than that to do something good for the downtown, which I assume is how you would sell them on this business improvement district. Hey, you'll pay taxes and you'll get this more parking or more something, right? So it's hard to hear these new things being bandied about, especially people that come and go and leave stacks of paper for you to look at that don't have a return on investment kind of thinking.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and City Council, staff, and public. I'm Catherine Acklin. I live at 565 Petaluma Avenue at the newer Petaluma Avenue Homes co-housing. I've never spoken before City Council before, so I want to tell you that I'm here because I think the situation's important. I'm here to offer support for local facilitation for the multi-use trails. I think that the situation, I represent the board of the Light Initiatives, which is an organization here in town that has supported car light in the past with getting cars off the road. We've developed community bikes, which is again a way to get people to ride and exercise rather than use pollution-causing automobiles. So anything we can do to lower the carbon footprint of Sebastopol, that's what we're up to. I've participated in the development a little bit, and all the board members of Light Initiatives that live in town have walked the multi-use trails. We see issues. We heard the meeting. We were here, and we see what neighborhoods are up in arms. It seems to me that a tremendous lot of work is done, and a great deal of work in creativity has gone into this by locals. But there's more to be done. And Light Initiatives is offering to facilitate a number of community meetings to build trust and to allow that all the neighborhoods that are affected and all the people that want to be connected to the downtown have the opportunity to be heard. We think that we can do this for $10,000. We'd like to see a space holder be put into your budget to wait to see after the election today if there's a Proposition A money available. We suggest that we design working with your staff this summer and council members, whatever, to get a process design that is fair and objective and has integrity. we're not trying, I'm not trying to do anything that's already been denied by the community. I'm trying to see what will work. So that means we need to have a lot of people talking and listening and understanding. It builds the community fabric to have these discussions. It's continuous with all the things I've heard tonight, from city slow to whatever. There's everybody saying, park the cars, get the pollution, get the gridlock down, make it safe, don't scare people. You know, this is not a dangerous thing. We're just talking about getting from your home to where you want to go. It's not all about commuter traffic. I'm not very interested in the people flying through here from one town to another. Let them use the Joe Rodota for that. Or, you know, if they use it, then be respectful. But my interest is really in the livability and the air quality in this town. So if we can be of some help, let us do it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm not speaking on behalf of Chief Oswald right now. I'm just Tasha for your personal community. But I have been working a lot with city staff with the website. I have nothing to gain by this. My background is in web technology. I just really wanted to emphasize the importance of a new website, and in fact that a new website in conjunction with financial software would be absolutely important to do together, because a lot of the opportunities you are missing right now is the ability to fill out forms online, and that has to be married to your software, your financial software. If you look at what other cities are doing, the web is a great way, and even the federal government uses the internet to facilitate some of these regulatory and, you know, things where you've got to fill out forms. So the numbers that are down there are very real numbers and not inflated at all, and your website is in trouble. It is not doing well, and not just for what it isn't doing, but or not just for what it could be doing but isn't now, but just it's not going to belong a lot longer. So I do highly encourage that you keep those in there and marry the financial software with the web development. Thank you.
Hi everyone, Diana Rich, Executive Director of the Sebastopol Community Cultural Center. First, just thanks for all of the hard work. I deal with numbers day in and day out. And looking at this huge document that Anna and the City Council and Finance Committee has been dealing with is pretty darn impressive. In terms of the capital improvements at the community center, I want to thank you for carrying over the $120,000 to deal with the accessibility issues with our new reception area, which was very important to me, and also for upgrading the bathrooms. I'd also like to respond a little bit to what Councilmember Gurney had to say about the grants. As some of you may already know, I did in fact request and fortunately received a grant from the new club, the Rotary Club, to take care of the landscaping in the front. So that's going to be done, which is absolutely fabulous. And there were five of them who were in the community center last week, replacing frames and putting up new doors. Rotary Club and Columbus are great groups. So I'm always open to that, always open to pursuing it. And I'd like to invite all of you, if you become aware of any grant opportunities that require some hard work in terms of getting the information together, writing things, I am always available to put that time and energy into money that might benefit the community center and thereby benefit the community in general. In terms of, I don't think you're going to have any extra money that you're dealing with this year, but if there is an opportunity to allocate any additional funds for the community center capital improvements, for instance, it would take about $25,000 to paint that big metal box. I would happily accept half that amount, and I would accept it on condition that I raise donated funds to match it. I would do that and absolutely put it at risk and take on the responsibility for matching that. So keep that in mind if there's one piece that's particularly important to the City Council as you view the building. There's the kitchen for about $30,000, there's painting for about $25,000, that's my faith, and there's about $30,000 for an arbor in the front. So thank you for all of your effort and all your help, and keep working, guys. You're fabulous.
Any other members of the public wish to speak on this item?
Good evening. My name is Andy Rogers. I'm here tonight as the executive director of the Russian River Watershed Association. I'm also a property owner downtown, and so I'm kind of embarrassed to say this is the first time I've presented to you guys. I've presented to some of your subcommittees, but anyway, it's nice to see you. And I appreciate all the work that you're doing. I know very well what putting these budgets together is like, but we do it in a much simpler way. We only have to deal with all the water stuff. You guys have the whole gambit, so hats off to you. So my understanding is that there's been a recommendation from the subcommittee that membership to the Russian River Watershed Association may not be renewed. And I wanted to just kind of be here to ask questions. I'm here at the request of our board of directors. Our chairman is Mark Landman, City of Itati. Vice chair is Bob Cox from Cloverdale. And then our board is made up of our 11 member agencies, which are all the municipalities, the regulated municipalities, and the Russian River Watershed. And that includes both the County of Sonoma, the County of Mendocino, the City of Ukiah is our administering agency, and then all the cities within. So our officers are also small cities, and really the budget development process for us, and I'll talk a little bit about some of the benefits before the red light goes on. Is a long process. It begins in September, and we try to get it done by the end of February. And what we try to do is an intense process. We have 9 public meetings, and we have 11 individual one-on-one meetings with agencies, and then we have a lot of discussions in between. And the goal is, by the time we get to February 26th, that everybody's really sick of hearing about it. They know very well that they want this work that we do, and we want it to represent the entire watershed. Now, the whole point of why RRWA was put together in 2003 was to pool resources. All cities have to do very similar things. So the idea is, why is everybody reinventing the wheel in all the different districts? Why not get together, have a very small staff doing a lot of things on behalf of all the agencies? And so that's where it came. So the budget has a complex formula to how everybody pays in, but basically small cities pay a much lower proportion of what is done. So things that I just want to mention, there's a lot of grant discussion tonight. Very savvy to be thinking like that. And in water, there happens to be a whole lot of money from the state that's being available. Guidelines for Proposition 1 are now out. They're not all that helpful yet. But basically, we have to get some applications in July. We would really like to have Sebastopol benefit from that, because the story we have to tell in the Russian River watershed is unique to California. No other watershed has organized all the regulated agencies under one voluntary stormwater permit, and I'm just talking about the stormwater. So we want to tell that story to the state, and we want to get some funding, and we'd love you to be a part of it.
Thank you.
So I could talk a lot about it.
And if I may ask, once the council takes this item up, sans council member Glass, if you would hang around, we might have questions that you may be able to answer. Are there any other members of the public who wish to speak on this? We will close public comment. Is that a request for a very, very brief break? Yeah. We can easily time.
Mayor, if I might, since that item is pertinent to a member of the public, perhaps we should take that up first.
That's what I was going to do.
Okay.
Exactly. Okay, then we'll just forge on. All right. So, Councilmember Glass, we'll just go ahead and get this one done first. Okay. You take a break.
I'm taking a break.
If you could turn the lights on in the lobby, we'd appreciate it. D-
discussion on this one line item. Council Member Eater, do you have, as the representative, some thoughts on this?
Yes, actually I do. The Russian River Watershed Association isn't a high profile, flashy, in the paper, you know, kind of organization that people, you know, I'd never even heard of them before I showed up at their first meeting, frankly. What they deal with is extremely complex, a lot of regulatory issues. I'm still getting used to all the acronyms. You know, I know that we're looking for ways to conserve funds, but I would want to direct a question to the city engineering director to get an idea of the complexity of the regulatory environment that the Russian River Watershed Association helps the city with, and if we were to not participate, how much staff time would need to be devoted to. Basically, the impression I've been given is right now, Mendocino County and Sonoma County and all the cities within Sonoma County are all kind of swimming as a team, and conceivably we might be out swimming on our own. And you know, I think that leaves the city open to, and I'm just looking for a frank discussion here, you know, if it leaves the city open to potential liability for omissions and errors in terms of not complying fully, if it's a lot of staff time that could be more efficiently, the work could be done in a collaborative setting, as it would be through the Watershed Association. And, you know, that's a concern I have, is that if we are out on our own, are we really saving $22,000? Or are we piecemealing it a little bit here and a little bit there, and next thing you know, we're not that far back to where we were originally? So I would invite the engineering director's comments in that regard.
First of all, to clarify what team we're swimming with, we are joining the phase one stormwater permit with the cities, all the other cities in our area and the county of Sonoma. It doesn't include cities outside of our county. So Mendocino has their own deal going under the stormwater permit. In terms of regulatory requirements that we must meet, we are primarily meeting those through our association with the other co-permittees, with whom we have numerous meetings every month we've been represented by our consultants who we hired to assist us to implement our stormwater program, move us into the new permit, and, you know, help us deal with all these regulations. I would like to say that the $22,000 we would spend with the Watershed Association was saving us a lot of duplicated effort, but I haven't seen that in the year that we've been participating. I don't see an avoided cost. There are some parts of the program we've participated in that wouldn't have been available to us, like purchasing urban creek care guides or being named on advertising for projects and such. There are other things that we're sort of paying for that I feel we're not getting. We don't have any Our Water, Our World presence at any of the nurseries in town, you know, the nursery facilities in town. There are, you know, there's a presence at Harmony Nursery and Grow Gardens, but neither of those are in the city. We're intending to participate in the trainings that we do need for our stormwater program so that our staff can become familiar with these incredibly complex new regulations, but trainings haven't happened yet. There are a couple of them scheduled for June, and I'm trying to get as many of our staff to go take advantage of that while we're still in and, you know, since we've paid into that for this year. But I really tried hard to think of an avoided cost, and I really honestly couldn't come up with one. I had one other thing I wanted to say. Oh, there are a number of other things that the Watershed Association does and participates in, but that the city is kind of already covered on some of these. We have safe medicine disposal as part of our partnership in the subregional wastewater reclamation system. That's an ongoing program that we actually fund through that agency. They also do a fats, oils, and grease elimination program. The Waste Management Agency that we are a member of produces a recycling guide and used oil disposal, and a number of other, you know, programs that are kind of overlap with things that the Watershed Association does. I know that there's been a lot of discussion at the Watershed Association about potential other things that RRWA could do for the co-permittees, but I know there's an equal amount of concern about duplication of effort. As far as I know, there is no regulatory requirement that we be a member of it, but there's some language in the new permit that's kind of equivocal, and we're reviewing the permit and we'll have comments on that. But at this point, I feel like we're spending as much of our resources as we possibly can working with the co-permittees group anyway. And, you know, I just wasn't able to come up with a benefit that was commensurate with the contribution when I was asked. So that's my
comment. All right, thank you. I was looking for a candid comment.
That was about as candid as I could be.
I think that was probably a question that I certainly had, and I would assume probably other stuff here. So regarding this one specific line item, do we need consensus on this? Do we need to actually vote on this one item?
If the council's prepared to give direction tonight on this item, then yes, you would do. Call for consensus, take a straw vote.
Okay. Yeah. Vice Mayor Gurney?
Well, since we're not seeming to do that on other items, I'm not sure why we need to do it on this one. Pardon me? Well, I know, but if we have to talk about it again, she can step outside again in another meeting. That's not a big deal, right? So I wanted to thank Andy for coming and make sure you know we did get the letter today, and let you know too, Mark Lamont did a good job. He called me at least twice, and I don't know if he got other people, but
he called me three different
times. Yeah. That's what I'm getting to. And I also wanted to acknowledge a communication from David Noren, encouraging us, and I think Mary might have circulated this one around to everybody today. And I was wondering, Mr. Mayor, if you thought it would be appropriate for Andy to comment again?
That would be fine.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Ms. Kelly, I totally hear what you're saying, and you know, nothing's perfect. We're certainly not perfect, and you know, the feeling that you're looking for is understandable. So I just want to respond that the way that we're set up, though, it's such a collaborative organization. There are, you know, we have 11 agencies that we're dealing with. I have 22 bosses at the technical level and the elected levels. So getting everything to move forward in within 1 year is pretty difficult. So in the training, so I'm just going to kind of respond to some of the things that are very valid concerns that Sue brought up. And in the training, it took all the way to June to get that, because what we use, we get folks from the other agencies to conduct the trainings, so we don't have to pay for an outside trainer to come in. And to get that scheduled, and in this case in June, we have two from Santa Rosa, we started in November. And the first dates we could get a room and a trainer and the certification and the confirmation was in June. So we pulled it off, but it was long. So we wanted to have it done in January. The OWOW is actually something that was set up by Santa Rosa originally, and it was put in the hardware store, which is a great thing, but it actually was put in the back. And so the OWOW folks thought there was not going to be a lot of awareness associated with that, and so they didn't want to use the stand time. So that was before we got involved, and this is one of those complex, you kind of got to be in the budget to understand. But we then became managers of that contract this year after Santa Rosa had set it up, and the OWOW folks said, you know, Sebastopol uses Harmony and Grab and Grow, and so they thought that would serve this, and the stands aren't physically located in the city limits, but it's the best we can do. And this is such an open dialogue that if there are other spots, and if you could help us get stands with somewhere and it makes sense in Sebastopol, we'll move it in a heartbeat. Safe Meds was mentioned, and yes, that's paid for the disposal and the collection, but none of the campaigns and the outreach associated with Safe Meds is paid for through the sub-regional system. That's through the RIUA. So we've done campaigns for veterinary medicine, we've done provider outreach just recently, a Spanish-speaking outreach, and all these campaigns are paid for through the RWA. I don't know if you heard, the Supreme Court approved Alameda's ordinance, and so Sonoma County may be moving forward, I'm guessing within the next couple years, political will. We're putting an ordinance for producer responsibility. That's important. We're going to be right on the forefront of that. One of the grant pieces that is going to be really big, but I just want to make sure, in the new permit, the stormwater permit that the draft has been circulated, there's a big monitoring component. So what the Water Board is saying is that we want you to have a regional monitoring plan, and we want the RWA to facilitate what that's going to look like. All we want to do is not create a new level. We want to repurpose funds so it goes to our regional monitoring program, and I admit this is too complex to really get detail, but ultimately it's going to be a lower cost for all the agencies. So all these valid points, I would have the same concerns if I were sitting over there, but they all are just kind of aspects of communication and just the reality of a collaboration that's regional. So stuff, not everything runs perfectly, but we do get it done. And I would love to address any more questions. And if you guys stay members, and even if you don't, I'd love to come back and give you more, you know, an informational item at some point to go over all this. You know, like I said, whether you're a member or not, we're all in the same watershed. We're all aiming for the same things. So I would offer that.
Thank you. Thoughts? Discussion?
Well, if I'm understanding the protocol for this evening, we're not going down this list necessarily thumbs up, thumbs down?
No, we're not. But in this specific instance, we need to reach some sort of consensus so that Councilmember Glass can rejoin us.
Okay. I didn't know if we were putting this off for an overall judgment on all the items.
No.
Okay.
Not right now. So, Councilmember Jacob?
I was going to suggest that we take in the information, that soak in,
to move along.
Next council meeting, and invite Councilman Glass back in and move along.
That sounds like a fine suggestion.
Yeah, that's kind of where I was going. Like, rather than drag this one out,
sure.
More like, let's move on to other things that she's able to participate in. I think it need to be clear that even though this item isn't shown as being funded currently, the dynamics of this whole list may change depending upon the outcome of labor negotiations. So, you know, nothing's safe, I guess.
Right. So what we need to do in order
to move it along, it is 9:30, is what I will do is ask if there are any specific items on page Roman numeral 10, or I suppose any other item in any of the departmental budgets. However, I believe that, this Roman numeral 10 is the that's the discretionary things. The rest of the budget is pretty well what it is. It's staffing, it's paper clips, it's things. So, thoughts on that page? Specific items? Anybody comes to read?
Well, I remain unconvinced of the tangible, measurable, quantifiable benefit of the proposal for an economic development services person, or at least at this point. And where I'm going with this is, you know, we've got $60,000 budgeted for that position, and I've gotten the impression that at the present time we don't even know what that person's going to do or what their duties or goals are. So I would recommend that we spend the time between adoption of this budget and mid-year budget adjustments defining and clarifying what that position is, and revisit at that point whether we want to fund it for a half fiscal year to kind of get it started. At that point, we'll be in a more knowledgeable position, and in theory, that frees up $30,000, in theory. I mean, just doing the straight math, right? So we know we have a requirement at the Center for the Arts right now that essentially is going to stop the ability of that facility to be used. Is that?
No.
No? Or okay, I'm sorry, I misspoke. What? It's going to prevent them from pursuing additional construction projects without the sprinklers being installed.
I believe on the their latest proposal on the north side.
Right, yeah, I'm sorry, I misspoke. It's not like you're going to red tag the building. I mean, they can't move forward with any additional construction projects. So right off the bat, we have a need, if we support that, to come up with $25,000 or $23,000. So that money has to be found. We have no breathing room right now for any increases due to labor negotiations. I myself would like to see the bike trail feasibility study funded to an amount of $10,000, and I think that could be done two ways. And they're both contingent upon amounts, so the $10,000 would be a placeholder. $10,000 contingent upon passage of Measure A. $10,000 contingent upon the availability and release of funds from the CBS settlement. There's two funding sources that don't impact the current general fund and the numbers we're looking at tonight. I walked around the outside of the library yesterday, and it was, you know, I don't know the details of the project, but I couldn't see anything that looked unfinished to me. It looked like it was acceptable at this point, so I'm wondering if that money or some portion of it could be made available as a funds to maybe to deal with labor negotiation costs. following on the comments made by Tasha Beauchamp, I think I'm hoping that one of the benefits of a redesigned website and financial software is that the city gains the ability to pay bills or pay online. I think it's a great step we've made with credit card receipt. I mean, credit card acceptance for paying your water bill, but if you could just log on and pay your water bill, that would be great. And I don't know, but I would hope it's not a big leap from where we're expecting to wind up now. And that's about it, really, for me right now. you know, I think we're running into a credibility issue on the multi-use trails issue in town with a lot of people. I mean, I got a letter from this gentleman named Roger Brown, and I think he put it really well. He said, a forward-thinking town like Sebastopol should be ashamed to be holding up the bike revolution. Well, I think that's a little overstatement, because we are putting bike lanes on 116, and we do have a plan to put them on city streets, but this is the kind of thinking that I get emails about all the time. And I think we're getting possibly the reputation of being a kick the can down the road city council on this project. And I think we need to make a definite, distinct move that establishes that this is a priority. And I think by putting a placeholder amount in this year's budget, again, with already two possible funding sources that don't come out of this amount of money, I don't see how the city can't at least start that process. And that's my comments for now.
All right. Further comments on anything on this page or any other page? Vice Mayor Gurney?
Well, I was just going to say, given the hour, the late hour, and the agenda item that Sue Kelly has coming up, I would prefer not to continue in that sort of conversation. I think Council Member Eater has put together some really strong points and good ideas, and I just don't feel like we have the time or energy to go back and forth on this table and do that, especially given the uncertainties that are going to be addressed probably in the next 2 or 2.5 weeks. Measure A, we'll know, we'll be close to finishing our labor negotiations, and then we will have to make those tough and frustrating decisions. Do we want the money to go here or there? I have comments, but I don't want to start talking about chairs, you know, at 20 to 10 at night.
I don't either. So have we discussed everything that we want to discuss tonight on the budget proper, and then we can move on to the capital improvement plan?
So yes, I need to continue this.
Okay.
Conversation.
Do we need a motion on that and a vote? Okay, so that was a first. Is there a second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
So let us continue to June 16th. Save everything.
Save everything. That's for sure.
All right. Let's just keep rolling. Item number, whatever this is, 5-year capital improvement plan 2015-2020, brought to us by our soon to be retired engineering director, Susan Kelly.
Let me give you the broad brush overview of what a CIP is, what it isn't, how it works. This is intended to be a 5-year planning document that includes the entire list of every public improvement that we've identified to date that needs to be done for one reason or another in this town, or that we want to do. It's listing of all the projects with some information about, or costs and orders of magnitude. It has information about how such projects are financed or not, as the case may be, and it's got a timetable in it. It should be reviewed annually by the council, and in the best world, each year's list becomes that fiscal year's capital budget. So in terms of actual budget, the 15-16 funded projects are your capital budget for next year. And let's see, what else do I have to say? It's important to remember that though we try to plan out infrastructure needs and get an idea of what kind of funding we will need to do the program, nothing that's in the list is constitutes a commitment of funding until it appears in a budget document. So things that we intend to build in 2018-19 may not get built then. They might get built sooner if there's an opportunity that presents in the form of a grant or other type of funding becomes available. But many of them will still be on the list at the end of the 5 years, just as many of the projects that are in this list have been on the list for some of them upwards of 10 years now. So the CIP document, the projects are aggregated from all the general plan, goal setting, bicycle plan, all kinds of planning documents, council discussions, staff identified needs in the infrastructure departments. That's where the list comes from. There are funding for these projects comes from a few basic areas. There's local funding, sales tax can fund capital projects, general fund that is. Typically, projects that are funded that way are building projects. Street rehabilitation is pretty much limited to local funding sources, unless we get grants, which we occasionally do, but they're pretty thin on the ground. Sewer and water enterprise funds, in the best world, generate capital that is contributed into the capital funds. But if you look in the back of this plan, you'll see that the five-year projections for sewer and water operations are going red in the next year or two. So that's capital sources drying up. That doesn't mean we're not doing any capital projects with them. We've used a lot of our water fund to commit to these well projects that we've been working on in the last few years. We do have some, we're a little more flush in the sewer fund. Unfortunate turn of phrase.
You've been waiting all night.
There's a little more money there, but not a lot. We get development revenues when new development projects come through. There are projections included in the plan in those areas too, traffic impact and park in lieu, but you see that they only go out for a couple of years and they're only based on our best estimate of when projects we already know about happen. And those don't always pan out either. So the funding picture is definitely a fluid, it's a moving target all the time. That's revenues. There's a lot of detail in the plan document, if you've read it, about where the money comes from and how it can be used and how it can't be used, etc. We've got a funding summary. The meat of this plan is the attachments at the back. That's a series of spreadsheets. The first couple ones are the revenue projections. Then there's an attachment four, which is a summary of all of the projects with information about their costs, and the tables that follow it list projects that are funded and are not funded. And you see a lot of red numbers on the individual category sheets for projects that we have not ever managed to identify funding for, notably things like storm drains, for which there's no dedicated funding, and we have to rely on general fund for those projects. And they've literally been sitting on that list ever since we identified them. Someday we're going to have to start paying the piper there as the storm drains begin to deteriorate worse and worse. So that's kind of that's the quickest and dirtiest way I can deliver it. I'm sure you've all read it and have questions, or haven't, but you have questions. That's the case, maybe. I'm here to answer them.
So, questions of staff?
Just one. I know I've parked renovation of $5 million. It's a long way off, and maybe a magic pot of money will fall out of the sky and we'll do it. But a smaller portion of that project, I believe, is the incorporation of the corner of Jewel and Willow into the park, if I remember correctly.
Yes.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if that can be looked at in, as a separate entity, because, you know, I live near there, and it's a very unsafe intersection, especially when we have, you know, the Cajun Festival and the concerts in the park, and people are crossing, and you've got to look five ways to see if you're going to get hit by a car. And I'm surprised we don't have huge numbers of injuries there. But I would support looking at doing that one little section, including that one little section of that major project in the CIP, if for no other reason to remove a public safety issue, or what I perceive to be a public safety issue, and eliminating that sweeping curve that allows a lot of speed buildup. I know it will have impacts potentially on the fire department in terms of response, but to create a T intersection with a stop sign so everybody knows what's going on. Okay, so
yeah,
that's
that, was, that particular item way back when I was on the planning commission and we were talking about the ice park improvements, and sort of was something I brought up was, hey, how do we fix this intersection? So that's how it all got started. And I've wanted to do something ever since it came out of my mouth. And I think that we could even do something that's virtually free temporarily to address that that particular
an asphalt berm, you know. But anyway, it's just an idea would be to not delay that project until the whole $5 million project could be accomplished. That's really the point here.
Do you want a reaction?
That's why we pay you to do it.
That's a new project. So that's a new project that hasn't been separately identified, or staff has not been received council direction to pursue that as a separate project. It was incorporated into the Ives Park master plan. I don't know what it would take to parse, you know, to take it out and make it a project all by itself. That's a project to figure it out. Staff can look into that. But in terms of this CIP, I wouldn't even know what number to put on it or what the project is. I mean, it's
just not a project.
It's not a project yet. If the council directs the staff to make it a project and start looking at it, but it would take some time to develop a scope for it and understand what it would take and how much it would cost and how it could be funded.
Did we pull ADA access to Ives Pool out of the master plan for Ives
Park? That is funded this year. The access piece is funded this year.
But was that part of the master plan for Ives Park
initially? It was initially. It was pulled out separately.
Okay. So pulling an item out is easy.
I'm saying it's not impossible, but it hasn't been done yet. So
great. Thank you.
I have no idea what the cost of that would be.
Lawrence.
I was with you. I think I was the chair of the planning commission when we did the Ives Park.
That was when it came back.
Well, I finished it.
Questions of staff.
I just want to say that I believe that incorporating that island into the park was one of the more extensive sections of the Ives Park master plan upgrade.
Yeah.
So it wasn't, it's a small piece, but significant amount of work to incorporate the island in and making sure that tree's protected. So I think that it was a larger cost, small project of the plan.
Because of the grade. Just if I put it simply, and I have a different concept for that, I think that is the most natural place for a roundabout in all of town, if it could fit. So let's just throw that one out. And so my question is, how do we get a new project? I mean, give us the steps, because I think John's going to be interested in his. I'm interested in repaving Willow. How do we get those on this list?
Well, the staff direction to include these projects in the list. There's a bunch of projects in here that we've received direction for in this list. McKinley Street sidewalks, gap closures on Bodega. Many of them are in plans that we have. Many of them were generated by council members in meetings just like this.
So we just have to agendize it, and then we'll get some initial input from you, and then it either goes forward or dies. Okay.
Yeah, and when I was preparing this document, I had not had that direction, so that's why it's not the first one tonight.
Just need to know that.
We have 5 years. You don't.
You have 5 years.
Who's going to own the CIP upon your departure?
I presume whoever replaces me.
It took you, since before I was on the council, to put this together. How long is it going to take a new person to understand it?
Well, hopefully we hire a person who already understands it. It's not a unique document to our city. Every city has them. So the person who, that's one of the main pieces of that job description, is the ownership and management of the CIP.
Sue is almost irreplaceable, but in certain of her tasks, as she states, we expect whoever takes her place to have that skill level.
Councilmember Glass?
I think I had this figured at one point, but I can't see it here tonight. So what's the number, the bottom line, the total on all unidentified funds?
I think that's in attachment 4, which is on page something. Starts on page A9. And it's the column on the right, far right in red, and the big number is 13 million and change.
Right. We'll stop paying the city manager for you.
No new chairs.
No new chairs.
You'll find a breakdown of that by what types of projects are in it, also on the pages that follow that summary sheet. There's a page for each
So I just have to reiterate, you know, from the standpoint of our budget, and that's a really big number.
We are just getting.
God bless America.
I mean, I guess the good news is that there's 10 million that's funded.
That's good news.
And not all these projects are weighted identically.
Yeah.
I mean, they all have different merits and different needs, and there is, it's not true that they're all needed now.
No, they can't all be priority number. That's another thing that the council has to deal with, is that there's a lot of competing needs, and as we just learned in our previous item, you've got to decide what really is number one priority. Because the other piece of it is that, you know, speaking of staffing, that the staff that's available to run this program, to implement this program, is very small. We do a lot of work with consultants, but somebody's got to manage them, and the workload prohibits doing everything all at once.
Yeah, I mean, how many years would it take you? If you had all 13 million, which really costs you a double, right? So if you had all the money you needed, how many years would it take for our city staff to implement these projects? It's probably over a decade.
Right, and I gave you a list somewhere in the document of all the projects that were completed since 2009 or something. It's something like close to 30 different capital projects. But that's about, I'd say that's about the capacity of your engineering department. That's right. About, and not just engineering, there's, you know, the public works department manages some of the projects, the other departments also.
It's 60 years.
But there's a limit to what a, you know, handful of people can do.
Right. So I just have a couple of questions. The first is the storm drain deficiencies. Is that something that is an enormous liability for the city to not be addressing at this point?
It could be if it results in regulatory violations. At this point, There's a one particular storm drain, the Valentine Avenue project, that we know is critical. The bottom of the thing is gone, and, you know, it's that pipe is old and it's just disintegrating. There are other ones, Rich may be able to speak to some of it. I think that's the most critical need.
Every couple of years, we have to go out and make repairs because another sinkhole appears in somebody's front yard.
That's what I was going to ask.
There's liability on that one. That's a priority.
And the other piece of it would be if they were leaking, I don't know. There's probably a variety of ills that could befall us. Mm-hmm. And the other projects have been on the list for a long time. We did recommend spending a big chunk of money doing an assessment of the storm drain system, because, like we're doing for the sewer system this year, because we don't really know what's critical out there.
Okay. And then the other question is, again, very specific to us, to the location. I'm not sure I saw it in here, and I looked fairly in a detailed way for it. The repair of Bodega and High?
Yes, it's in.
It is.
Yes. It's in here, and I think it's, let's see, where is it? You look on A9 under transportation under the pavement program. It's about the fifth project listed down there, and we showed it to occur in
16-17.
All right. And there is, that would be funded if it stays in there in that position.
Yeah, if it could hold out that long.
It already did.
Yeah, glad they renewed the duct tape around the sign.
Yeah.
Okay. So again, with this, we can continue this to our next meeting, unless anybody. Oh, I should ask for public comment.
Can we finish it?
It's up to you. I'll be here on June
16th.
You need to conduct.
Councilmember Reeder?
Just one more. My recollection of the fourth bay addition to the fire department building was around $500,000. The first budget year I participated in this, and now it's at $800,000?
Yeah, and climbing.
So it's grown $300,000 in the last 2 years?
I think. 2 years ago, that was just a ballpark estimate, but I went out and got some estimates from some general contractors, and it ranged between $500,000 to $800,000, and climbed, unfortunately.
Okay.
That's right, the cost of fire sprinklers. So I guess we don't need to continue this.
I think if you want to continue it, you need to open the public hearing first. You at least need to open the public hearing.
Right, and the item is to not make decisions necessarily off of this, but just to conclude as to whether it's a proper CIP plan.
Yes.
I see. I did. I asked for public comment on this public hearing.
I heard you.
And there was nobody, so I closed public comment on the public hearing. So we can either continue this, or we can accept it and approve it as presented.
I move to provide direction to staff for adoption and approval of the CAP.
Is there a second? Any discussion?
Is there any desire to add any projects to this?
I think that would be an agenda item in the future.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Correct.
So I'll call the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Discussion and action for approval of recommendation to mayor and/or some county mayors and council members association meeting. This one is probably a pretty fast one. We've got some folks who are simply seeking reappointment to current email positions, and then we have a Santa Rosa council member who is looking for appointment to a currently vacant alternate position.
Yay.
So is the direction to the mayor to vote for everybody?
I'll second it. I just have a question to make sure I understand. So we have one person per opening?
Yes.
Okay, we're good. I'm good with that. Okay.
So we have one position, we have several people applying. The one that Gary's talking about.
There are three openings.
There's three openings.
Yeah. Okay. So it's Dolasso, Wysocki, and Hill. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So that's how I will vote on that. And now we have reports.
Yay.
Any reports of anybody?
I report.
Okay.
I have one quick report. Let me just get, see if I can remember what it was. Oh, it's just another compliment to staff. Saturday morning I did receive another complaint. This was about the restrooms on the plaza. I reported to staff, and Rich is already on it with his guys. It's amazing. How responsive and professional staff is. Also, you did see the signs go up at the Laguna Ridge, so the construction will start soon.
I had one of those two. Staff was right on it.
Right on.
Thank you, Ela. And public. Now we're going to have our closed session.